So it doesn't happen. I have no, no name. It's true. I still have my contact. Oh, it was the subway was kind of due, but the buses were faster. Well, they went both ways.
I got a free fine. I didn't push it there all trucks.
So we saw it dropping.
Who was the color today?
Good morning, everyone. I'll call our assembly to order, and I'd ask Councilor Hurley to lead us in prayer and pledge today.
Dear Lord, we thank you for all that we've been given in life, and we offer prayers and remembrance for those people who've been victims of gun violence and man's inhumanity to man. We hope for a better spirit to come over us and to be a loving and kind nation once again. Amen.
And to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd ask Councilor Kennedy for a motion to record advice and consent for the financial warrant.
So moved, Governor.
Is there a second?
May I move for a roll call?
Yes, there's a motion and a second. A request for a roll call. We may commence the roll call.
Councilor Pereira?
Yes.
Councilor Jupova?
No.
Councilor Devaney?
No.
Councilor Iannella?
Yes.
Councilor Duff?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Hurley?
Yes.
I call Councilor Duff for a motion to record advice and consent for the pending list of notaries, public, and justices of the peace.
So moved, Governor.
Is a motion?
Second.
A second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
I recognize Councilor Duff for a motion to record advice and consent for the appointment of Jenny L. Caissie to the position of Clerk-Magistrate of the Devenay District Court.
So moved, Governor.
Second.
Is a motion? Second. Councilor Devaney?
Please pardon my voice. I have a cold. I apologize. First of all, to the Governor, I think we should recognize Mr. George, who is the Clerk-Magistrate in Devenay Court. He has been serving nearly 3 years since January 2017, and I think we should thank him for his service, so I just wanted to say that. Lieutenant Governor, I am asking you to allow my statement to stand as I have presented it. Governor Cerucci had a rule, which was enforced, prohibiting everyone in his administration from applying to another public position for 6 months and a day after leaving your present state employment. This vote that I am asked to make for a member of the Governor's Council to be a clerk magistrate may not be against the law, but I believe it is unethical and unacceptable to the citizens of Massachusetts. No sitting councilor should be allowed to apply for a judicial position. This governor's counselor competed against qualified people of the public who applied for that position. This is not an open and fair process in any sense of the term. We are asked today to confirm a sitting governor's counselor who serves on the very body responsible for confirming judicial nominees. How can we explain to constituents that the nominee demonstrates commitment when she ran for re-election for governor's counselor and then 3 months after being sworn in, she applied for a magistrate position? How do we answer to the people who ask why the nominee does not have to resign from the council before she applies for her magistrate? Councilor Caissie is still receiving salary for her present position as governor's counselor, as we vote here today. How can anyone justify Councilor Caissie accepting her counsel interviewed by the JNC and was informed he would have the deputy job. He advised me that a few days later, he was notified that he would be transferred to the Westfield District Court. Clearly, this position of Clerk-Magistrate for Deputy Court was set aside for Councilor Caissie. In fact, there was no Westboro public poster. It had long been closed. How can we call this a blind application process? How blind is the process when JNC members are looking at an application questionnaire that identifies the person and states present governor's counselor? Officially on paper, there is a thorough vetting process by 21 lawyers, the Judicial Nominating Commission, JNC, which are appointed by the governor to hold interviews with the nominees and issue recommendations to the governor. In fact, there never have been 21 JNC members present in this administration interviewing any nominee in 5 years. You know how I know? Because I've interviewed every nominee in 5 years. Nearly half of the JNC members vote for a nominee for a lifetime position without attending the nominee's interview and without ever even seeing the nominee. As I reminded Councilor Caissie at her hearing last week, 5 years ago she said she would be a judge if Governor Baker was elected. At her hearing, I asked her, since being a judge has been your stated desire, will you commit to serve as a clerk magistrate for 5 or 6 years? She gave no answer. I asked, will you be looking for a judgeship while serving as a clerk magistrate? Again, she gave no answer. In the meantime, Council Caissie will receive a salary of $155. Clerk magistrates, by the way, do not have a mandatory retirement age as judges. I advised Councilor Caissie at her hearing that I would treat her the same as other nominees before me. But I have to recognize there's at least one difference. It is not known whether the nominees who come before us go to court late, run in after their cases, but I do know about because I am present at the council hearings every week until the end of the hearings. Commitment is important. I hear about distance to the state house all the time. When you run for governor's council, you know where the state house is, and you know the distance from your home. A counselor is only required to come to the state house one day. In the courthouse, you're required to come 5 days a week. Councilor Caissie does appear for the 15-minute public assemblies to vote yes for all the nominees. I asked Councilor Caissie at her hearing about her inability to attend a complete governor's council hearing and not able to attend after the hearings. I asked, how would she resolve this problem when she's a clerk magistrate going to the courthouse? I asked if she could commit to being in the courthouse 8:30 to 4:30, and sometimes I talk to clerk magistrates, a session can run over to 5:30 to 6. Councilor Caissie is still receiving a salary for her present position as governor's counsel as we vote. How can anyone justify Councilor Caissie accepting her council salary at her own council hearing? Now, is this a conflict of interest? Just a couple of weeks ago, Councilor Caissie chaired a hearing and voted for the nominee who applied for the very same deputy clerk magistrate position she applied to. Both applicants for the same position. Police Officer McCarthy, the nominee, told me when he met that he was interviewed by the JNC and was informed he would go to have the deputy job. He advised me that a few days later, There was no Westboro public posting to get lawn closed. How can we call this a blind application process? How blind is the process when JDC members are looking at an application questionnaire that identifies Chris, present governor's counsel? Officially on paper, there is a thorough vetting process by 21 lawyers, the Judicial Nominating Commission, JDC, which are appointed by the governor to hold interviews for nominees and issue recommendations to the governor. In fact, there have never been 21 JDC members present in this administration interviewing any nominee in 5 years. I know, because I interviewed every nominee in 5 years. Nearly half of the JDC members vote for a nominee for a lifetime position without attending the nominee's interview and without ever even seeing the nominee. As I reminded Councilor Caissie at a hearing 5 years ago, she said she would be a judge if Dr. Baker was elected. In her hearing, I asked, since being a judge has been your stated desire, do you commit to serve as a clerk magistrate for 5 or 6 years? She gave no answer. I think I read this before, didn't I?
You did.
I'm sorry. I've got a cold and you can deal with me. Okay. So, I said that I, you know, there's a difference between coming late here and going to court, because the council hearings will go and it'll continue no matter how few councils are here. But the court is different. And you have to be there because people are paying a lawyer and they're, you can't. And a clerk magistrate can't come in at the end of the clerk's hearing and issue a decision. I want to say this from the heart. I find no joy in having to evaluate a colleague, but I'm charged to do so. Never in my 20 years serving did I ever imagine that I would be asked to vote for a sitting colleague on the governor's council for a judicial. I cannot participate in this flagrantly boring process. It is absolutely unfair to the citizens of Massachusetts who believe it is an open process when they apply for clerk magistrate or any other judicial position. A governor's council shouldn't be competing with the nominee. How can we, in good faith, ignore a qualified applicant and instead confer a job to a person who sits on the left, on the right, or across from us? Can we encourage people in our districts to apply for these judicial positions and convince them that it's a fair process? There are no words adequate to describe this lack of open governmental process and lack of transparency. On behalf of the citizens of Massachusetts, I want you to let me know. I respect this.
Anyone else like to be heard? We may begin the roll call.
Councilor Devaney? Councilor Devaney?
No.
Councilor Iannella?
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Hurley?
Yes.
Councilor Brewer?
Yes.
Councilor Junville?
No.
We have a new nomination today. Nathan A. Byrnes has been nominated to the position of clerk magistrate for the Westfield District Court. Councilor Hurley, do you have a date and time for the hearing?
Yes. That hearing will be on October 2nd at 1:30 in the afternoon.
What time, sir?
1:30.
October 2nd. At 1:30 for the afternoon.
Wait a
minute. October 2nd, 1:30 for Nathan Burns.
Thank you.
Lieutenant Governor, we have a Court when we come in. There should be rush that we have a 1:30 the same day. I have asked over and over that we have one hearing. Mine is scheduled for 11 o'clock. We break with you at 12. There is no way that we're going to rush through a Superior Court hearing to get to Councilor Hurley's 1:30 appointment. And I am begging this council not to have the same day. Could you, through the chair, Councilor Hurley, make it the next week?
No.
Thank you, thank you, sir.
Councilor Iannella.
Yeah, 1:30 works fine for me, but can we have some assurance here? If that one goes longer, no idea how long her hearing is going to last. If we're going to finish one hearing. We can't have two hearings at the same time. Well, she can start as a four. I mean, I just want to make sure that your hearing will start after the next hearing. I think, can I get that assurance?
I don't have a crystal ball, but it seems to me that's probably going to be the case.
You won't guarantee me that if hers goes till, you won't start another hearing. You don't start yours earlier.
The reason I'm doing it next week.
I have no problem with what
you're saying. The reason I'm doing it next week is because the witnesses are going to include the First Justice of the Westfield District Court. He is then going on vacation. So it's my intention that we get the witnesses out of the way if I have to continue until the next week to get it over.
I'm here till 8 o'clock. I have no problem. But I just want to make sure that if hers goes on till 2 o'clock, you're
that's
not
fine.
Going to stop yours at 1:30 and a different somewhere else in the
right.
Building.
No.
That's all.
As a point of
personal privilege,
yes.
I want to tell you, Lieutenant Governor, you were here. I had a hearing that was going over, and as it was practice is, and I know Councilor Hurley had a break for lunch and a bathroom break when we did a parole board, and when I tried to do it, our counselor one, District 1, he decided that he was going, when I made a break, that he was going to have his second hearing.
And that's 15, his right.
15 minutes. 15 minutes was that hearing because it's on the record. I can't believe Springsteen ignored the chair that's saying we're going to have recess like everyone else. And everyone hears 15 minutes. What a disgrace. 15 minutes for the nominee, the two witnesses, and five counselors. And you know what? No one came back to my hearing except Counselor Iannella and Counselor Julie Bill. Let's show respect here.
All right, that concludes our meeting today. Can I just say something? I wanted to say I appreciate the administration and the governor in banning the vaping products as a public health concern. I encourage them to relook at some of the gun laws as a public health concern.
Thank you, Counselor.
I just want to counsel that.
Judge Hurley, could you make it at 2 o'clock?
Right.
2 o'clock.
If you're here,
you make it at 2 o'clock.
I'd like to have him here.
Because we're not going to make it at 1:30. I'll take it.
And that's fine. I don't have a problem.
No, it isn't. It's not fair for them to wait. Make it at 2. And I'll do my best to get it through.
You run your railroad the way you want to. I will run mine the way I want to.